things that I may never see again. I can't wait to get on the road again. On the road again. Thank you. Well, life on the farm is kind of laid back. Ain't much an old country boy like me can't hack. It's early to rise, early in the sack. Thank God I'm a country boy. Well, a simple kind of life never did me no harm. Raising me a family and working on the farm. My days are all filled with an easy country charm. Thank God I'm a country boy. Well, I got me a fine wife, I got me old fiddle. When the sun's coming up, I got cakes on the griddle. And life ain't nothing but a funny, funny riddle. Thank God I'm a country boy. When the work's all done and the sun's setting low, I pull out my fiddle and I'm rosin up the bow. The kids are sweet, so I keep it kind of low. Thank God I'm a country boy. I'd play Sally Gooden all day if I could, but the Lord and my wife wouldn't take it very good. So I fiddle when I can and I work when I should. Thank God I'm a country boy. Well, I got me a fine life, I got me old fiddle. When the sun's coming up, I got cakes on the griddle. Life ain't nothing but a funny, funny riddle. Thank God I'm a country boy. Woo! My life for diamonds or jewels. I never was one of them money hungry fools. I'd rather have my fiddle and my farming tools. Thank God I'm a country boy. Yeah, city folk driving in a black limousine. A lot of sad people thinking that's a mighty keen. Well, son, let me tell you now exactly what I mean. I thank God I'm a country boy. Well, I got me a fine wife, I got me old fiddle. When the sun's coming up, I got cakes on the griddle. Life ain't nothing but a funny, funny riddle. Thank God I'm a country boy. My fiddle was my daddy's till the day he died. And he took me by the hand, held me close to his side. Said, live a good life, play my fiddle with pride. Thank God you're a country boy. Well, my daddy taught me young how to hunt and how to whittle. Taught me how to work and play a tune on the fiddle. He taught me how to love and how to give just a little. And thank God I'm a country boy. Well, I got me a fine wife, I got me old fiddle. When the sun's coming up, I got cakes on the griddle. Life ain't nothing but a funny, funny riddle. I'm a country boy, yes!
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome along to the Adelaide Oval, and what a fitting place for us to be here today to celebrate the state funeral and the celebration of the life of a remarkable and wonderful man, Neil Kerley, who is a country boy in the true sense of the term. I'd just like to acknowledge before we get underway that the land we meet on here today is the traditional lands of the Kaurna people and that we respect their spiritual relationship with the country. We also acknowledge the Kaurna people as the custodians of the Adelaide region and that their cultural and heritage beliefs are still as important to the living Kaurna people today. We also pay respects to the cultural authority of Aboriginal people attending from other areas of South Australia. Welcome to all of you. In particular, there are some people I would like to acknowledge individually. Mrs. Barbara Kerley and family, great to have you here. Brigadier Hannah, representing the Governor-General of Australia, Her Excellency the Honourable Francis Adamson, Governor of South Australia, and Mr Bunton, the Honourable Peter Malinauskas, Premier of South Australia, parliamentary representatives, distinguished guests, friends, his colleagues here, former teammates, and even some enemies on field who were very dear, dear friends off the field. We're going to acknowledge what has been a truly, truly remarkable life. In terms of a football sense, Neil, as an incredible man, had an amazing journey. He made his debut as a teenager for West Adelaide back in 1952, and 41 years later found himself as a senior coach at the same club. In between, across five decades, have a think about this, the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, and the early 90s, Kerls played 276 games for West, South and Glenelg. He coached at all of those clubs in addition to Central District and West Torrens. There are four premierships, five best and fairest, 32 state games, that's as a player, and then also there are many as a coach. He was pivotal in the early roles of the Adelaide Football Club, and he certainly lit up our TV screens, often alongside Dipper as a boundary rider on Channel 7 for the AFL broadcasts. I think it is really fitting that we are here at the Adelaide Oval, and just behind all of you here, it's a stadium that housed countless memorable moments for Kerls. There was a 61 flag for the Bloods in scorching temperatures. He remarkably took South from bottom to top in a season, as many of you know. Peter Daly, you'd know very well because you were certainly one of his favourites. He also helped break a 39-year premiership drought for the Tigers here in 1973. It's also a place where he spent time advising KG Cunningham and his colleagues on how they could better do their jobs. If we go from out there on that field to right here in this room, even though it's a newer type room, obviously with the redevelopment of the Adelaide Oval, this is a room itself where the King often held court. Whether it was a SA Football Hall of Fame or McGarry Medal Night, whether it was a Carbine Club luncheon, or even 4 years ago, it was the 55th anniversary of that famous 1963 victory when SA got over the Vicks at the MCG and came back like rock stars. Kerl stood up here 4 years ago and recounted everyone in the South Australian team in position. Then he went through all the Victorian teams in position. He was sharp as a wit, and he was very proud to say that he ended Alistair Lord's game very early on. He said to the team before that game, all you need to do is go and get the footy because something's going to happen. I'm going to make it happen. You don't have to worry about what it is. Made it happen. It was one of the most famous victories that South Australia ever had in state football. I'd like you now, please, to put your attention to the screens. Let's celebrate the great man, Knuckles.
Winning to me was very, very important.
It's got to be about 8 years since you were last at Victoria Park as a player.
1986, I actually kicked three goals that day, Sandy, so I remember that very well.
Have mentioned it.
When I married him, he wasn't a legend. He was just a footballer.
I've just rung her this morning and she's still crying. And I am as well.
Kerls, there's only one of him. Yeah, he was a one-off. He was the most motivated man I've ever come across.
I won two Football of the Year trophies, voted by past players. I rate that better than a medal.
I just loved him like I love my dad, really. But he was just a good bloke. That's what I liked about him. I loved his stories.
There was nobody quite like Kerls when it came to that state rivalry, SA versus the Big V.
How are you, Dipper? I'm very good, thank you, Bruce, and good evening, boys. Now, Kerls, I haven't seen you since the state game. All I've got to say is, welcome back to the MCG.
Tell you what, Neil, I'm here tonight to show my colours and have a look at this, all right? There it is. Have a look at that.
Would you have liked to play it over there?
I would have, just to show them that there were some people in South Australia that were capable of playing in the VFL.
Why didn't you take it?
Because I like South Australia.
We were cellar dwellers until Neil Kerley marched into the club and established his own set of rules.
And a lot of people get to 80, they're just about stuffed. But I feel there's still life out there, there's adventure out there still to go.
Look, every day's an adventure.
I know he was a very good footballer. Just remember him as my brother.
How would you like to be remembered?
As a person that gave everything he possibly had to win.
In the crowd there are some great moments. I'd like to now welcome Neil's daughter Gail, son-in-law Lee, and grandson Campbell to join us.
you, Mark. Before I say a few words about Dad, I would like to acknowledge my beautiful mum, Barb. Sorry. You have shown amazing strength and resilience over the past 3 weeks. And as usual, you have handled everything with grace and kindness. I'm very proud of you, Mum, and I know that Dad would be as well. I thought I would start with my earliest memories of Dad. During the year, we didn't really get to see very much of him. As he was coaching, he worked full-time, and he also had many media commitments. Well, Christmas Day was the beginning of our family time. Every year, we had our famous Brandy Alexander morning, and over 50 family and friends would come to our home at Bellevue Heights. Sometimes we would end up with some extra lunch guests, as Dad's brew could be a little strong sometimes. Boxing Day, we would head up to our Hungbull shack at the river until the day before school went back. In the early days, we didn't have a TV or phone, just a tape deck, some cassettes, our ski boat, a diving board, and our wood-burning barbecue. This was our special family time. There was always a tournament of some sort going on at Walker Flat. Table tennis, tennis, bocce, volleyball, backgammon, crib, even who could hit the golf ball across the river the furthest. Dad was always involved and, of course, loved to win no matter what it was. As a dad, you were strict but fair and maybe a little too fair with me. Mum always said I had you wrapped around my finger. You're also extremely generous and very welcoming and hospitable. Some weekends, Kirsty and I would turn up to the river with a carload of friends, and I'd say, sorry guys, I've brought a few extras. He would always respond, not a problem, pet, come on in, girls. He nicknamed my girlfriends the Water Ballet. You were also very supportive of me, Donald and Robin, and very patient as well. You taught so many people to water ski, whether they wanted to or not, and sometimes I think people just held on because they were too scared to let go of that rope. It worked. You loved my family and welcomed Lee as one of your own. The special bond you had with Campbell I'll always cherish. So for now, Dad, cast your rod, pour yourself a red, turn on the footy and relax. You deserve it. I'm going to miss you every day, Dad, but you're living here now. Until we meet again, love your pet.
Afternoon, everyone. Hello, fellow workers. I'm going to talk a little bit about Neil as a father-in-law to me. I've been lucky to have two of the best father figures in my life, my dad and Neil. Neil to me was a leader of wisdom, advice, and strength. A man's man, a family man, and someone I looked up to. A competitor who didn't like to come second at anything. A great storyteller, raised a great family that I'm lucky to be part of. Always made me feel welcome in the home, always helping out and being there for my family. Always generous and always positive. He was my father-in-law, my friend. From the first handshake, to working on the roof within the first hour of meeting Neil, to the next day cleaning the block septic tank, the things you pay for when you have to date his daughter. But I earned his respect and his trust. We became best mates. I became his golf partner at Royal Swan Reach until someone better came along, as I was dropped then to the reserves. I got to meet his golf mates, in which I got to play with most of them, as I was on Neil's reserve list. We did lots of fishing, catching yabbies, and watching footy together. I learnt a whole new way of watching footy. At half time, we'd switch off the footy and then we'd head to Fox Classics to watch a John Wayne movie, then go back to watch the last half. I also learned that cheating was allowed in the Kerley house. Cheating, especially playing golf, when you're putting to win, and Neil would then deliberately drop the flag or cough, all for playing for a holy dollar for the win. Excuses were also especially especially playing bocce. If I had a toenail over that line, Neil would call re-bowl. But when Neil bowled and stumbled over the line, he would say, "Jesus, my balance has never been the same since my diving accident." And his ball would count. Excuse me. I learnt that the holy golf dollar was worth more than a dollar. If you had won the day, you didn't have to cook the barbecue or get the beers for the rest of the day. You actually had a waiter. Phone conversations with Neil were very, very short. He would ring up and ask a question, and once the question was asked, he would say, "Cheers," and hang up. I've never once had a longer conversation than a minute within 17 years. But Neil, I will surely miss your stories, our golf days, watching footy and solving the footy problems, our fishing adventures, your famous chicken wings and callop, the 5 o'clock beer and the barbecues. Neil is a proud South Australian, a great man, a great father-in-law. Thank you for letting me into your life and sharing lots of memorable moments. You always made me happy, and as you would always say when saying goodbye, all the best. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm here to talk about my pa. My first memory of Pa was when Pa and I were watching golf together, and Pa was sitting in his reclining chair up at the river. I was sitting on Pa's lap, playing with the controls of the recliner, making the chair go back and forth. He then called for my mum to come and get me. Pa meant a lot to me, not because he was a football legend, but he was my mentor. He had a huge influence on my life. He taught me how to be positive and competitive, but he also taught me how to be respectful and gentlemanly. Pa always made our times together really fun and enjoyable. An example is how he taught me how to drive on the back roads at the river from the age of 12. He said I was a really good driver. Playing golf with Pa was an experience to say the least. He cheated, but that's what made it so much fun. Whenever I would hit a bad shot or hit a short putt, he would pay me out. So whenever he hit a bad shot, I'd return the favour. Up at the river or even at home, he would be stuck to the TV watching football. That was also very funny and entertaining. Baba would go into her room so she could not stand the noise level coming from the lounge room. Dad, Pa, and I would often go fishing together in the tinny. We had good days and bad days, but Pa never gave up, no matter how long we were out on the water for. Christmas Day was a great time to be with Pa because he made his special drink named the Brandy Alexander. I thought it was one of his crazy inventions, but I was wrong. One Christmas, he taught me how to make it and serve it using the bucket and the old egg beater. Pa and technology did not get along. Every time Mum and I would arrive at the river, my first task was to fix his phone, which was deleting messages and making new contacts. He somehow lost a phone because it slipped out of his pocket when he was getting into the boat and fell into the river. I'm so grateful to have a grandfather like Pa. He was one of the scariest people I've ever met, especially when I was being disrespectful to my mum. He would grab my arm and say, "Be kind to your mother," in his angry voice. But he was one of the kindest people I've ever met, and I'll miss him so much. Thank you.
Beautifully spoken. Campbell, you've learned some good lessons from your pa, haven't you? He set you very nicely on your way. You're going to be a chip off the old block, I think. Curls, as we said before, coached at 5 clubs, which is quite amazing when you think about it. He coached West Torrens from 77 to 1980. And our next guest was club chairman during some of that time. And he not only lured Neil to the club, but Wayne Jackson, while he was the chairman, remarkably had to be Curl's runner at the same time while he was coaching, until the club said, "You better stop that." Can you please welcome Wayne Jackson to deliver the eulogy?
Well, ladies and gentlemen, or as Lee said, fellow workers. And that greeting will be familiar to those of you who knew Neil well. I love Neil Kerley. The terrific and respectful crowd at this Adelaide Oval today supports the regard and affection we all felt for Neil and continue to feel for Barbara and Gail and family. I wish to briefly recount Neil's time at the mighty Eagles Football Club. In the late 70s, when I was chairman, as Mark said, and president, and Neil's runner. From the team's very lowly position, Neil's influence on our players and the rest of the club's community too took the Eagles in three short years to the finals. And in so doing, re-established our faith in the club and the broader culture of football. But this afternoon, I wish to only highlight two of the many footy scenarios in which I was involved with Neil, and which may dispel or dilute the opinions or views of many football followers. In 1966 at Thebourne Oval, I played a game in which the Pughole Diggers, that was us, versus Glenelg, at the time Neil was captain coach of the Tigers. Our Eagles coach instructed me to shadow Kerley, i.e. sacrifice a scrubber to try and minimise the influence of the champ. As we prepared for the first bounce, I niggled Neil just a little, only to be told, not you, Jacko, bugger off. I'll tell you what, we will wax or swap. Five for me, one for you. Neil was best on the ground with 30 touches. So notwithstanding the magnificent attributes which I'm sure will be outlined by Peter and Graham, Neil as well had the intellect and humour to seize the moment in the heat of battle. A second myth or recall, this time off field, was that Neil always had the first penny that he earned. In fact, he was very fair, very generous, and a very caring person. As chairman, I was able over several weeks to outline to Neil why he may like to coach the Eagles. He finally and enthusiastically agreed to do so. We shook hands. Deal done. And then I pointed out, we haven't even talked salary or the coaching fee. Neil's response was, pay me what you think is a reasonable amount. I know you will be fair. No negotiation, no pressure. These were not the actions most would have anticipated from a man with Neil's reputation as being very careful with his pennies and a hard negotiator. But I wish to say a few words about Neil and his non-football life, that of his formative years and his characteristics as a friend, travelling mate, and mentor to many. Neil and Barbara purchased their shack, now long their home, at Walker Flat 50 years ago. The River Murray has long been a massive part of Neil's life, being brought up as one of six children living on a small vegetable block at Loveday near Barmera. His dad, Laurie, was a national serviceman who was wounded in the war and died when Neil was only 11 years old. Neil was a legacy lad. He left school at 14 and then worked at that time picking up mallee roots for a local carrier. Neil's mum, Lillian, was of Irish descent and laid down what would become the framework later in Neil's life. To do things right the first time. Don't cheat and don't ever, ever give in. At 16, Neil left Loveday on a motorbike and for 2 years worked in the outback, spending weeks alone as a boundary rider, only with a shovel, a crowbar, and a pair of pliers. His hands were often red raw, and at night he would pee on his calluses to clean them and harden them. Neil returned from the bush for a national service call-up and went to Cooley Milka, a Labor camp near the Woomera Test Range, and where his football nous and leadership skills became evident. As you will hear later, the rest is footy folklore. Neil and Barbara married in 1956. 66 years of wedded bliss, he often boasted. But away from footy, there was a life to be lived, and he did not waste a day. In the early days of their marriage, the Kerleys purchased, in partnership, the first tuna licence in Boston Bay. An outstanding business developed, which only changed as they went fishing for abalone. Concurrently, Neil had an outstanding sales career at Stillwell Ford, working with his great mate, the late Graham Bignall. As well as a strong media commitment, Neil dilly-dallied in a menswear store in Hyde Park, was an agent for health food supplements. It was a terrible breakfast, pre-breakfast stuff. And more pleasingly, he learnt to cook chicken wings. In the mid-1980s, Neil's football career took another turn when he was approached by the South Australian Syndicate to support our challenge for the America's Cup in Fremantle. Neil was to undertake the multitasks of fitness training, skipper of the tender vessel Magna, and shore management at Fremantle. Here, Neil's negotiation skills did come to the fore when he went home to tell Barbara he'd taken a job and he'd be away for a while. Barbara protested that he knew nothing about sailing or yachting, to which he retorted, "I'll be driving Magna, the tender boat." And then Barbara asked, "Well, how long will you be away?" Neil's response, "Maybe 2 or 3 years." Neil's negotiation skills did not help him some years later, as he padded home in his outboard dinghy early morning from one of his many yabby trips upstream from the Walker's Flat Punt. He taught me how to recognise his yabby pots. Not bad, since I'm red-green colourblind. Unfortunately, I hadn't taught Neil to count. And 720 yabbies later, he was facing a criminal charge, for the allowable quota was 200 yabbies. And the investigating fishery officers revelled in catching out a high-profile fish. Neil and I, particularly David Birchall, for many years took off after the footy season into the Australian outback. Anywhere north from Uendamoo, Birdsville, Longreach, and back down the rivers to Wentworth, and all in between. We were always welcomed by station owners and managers, because Neil's reputation meant, via the Bush Telegraph, that we were en route and not that far away, and that we shut gates, could find and check isolated tanks and trophies. We reduced the dingo numbers, we mowed lawns, we mixed in with the ringers and had beers with the jackaroos. And Neil always ran an evening crib school for the manager or owners, played, of course, to his rules. We often didn't know where we were for days, because we were isolated and only on bush tracks. But as Neil said, the sun comes up in the east, north is on our right, so south, and therefore Adelaide, must be down that way somewhere. Neil always had a small yabby net, a fishing hand line and a rifle, so he never went hungry. I've often seen him shoot ducks on Cooper Creek, in season of course, and then swim out to collect them. Waste was to be avoided. We shared the view that there's little more valuable than being able to share experiences and real life issues, confidentially and with close mates, and particularly around a fire at night. Those who joined in one of the many trips always felt privileged to be part of Neil's company. Finally, Neil slowed down just a little. Days of early morning fishing, yabbing, helping wounded ducks, and afternoons of watching sport, meeting commitments in Adelaide and elsewhere, morphed into playing golf, usually twice a week, with a small group of mates who I see here today. For the past 20 years, like Neil, Neil, like his mates, was a non-stop, energetic volunteer, as he called it, at the Royal Swan Reach Golf Club. The group collectively have, to Neil's pride, built the club into an A-grade venue and an A-grade golf course. In the morning, golf, a working bee in the afternoon, and Neil's damn chicken wings for lunch. And so, whether as an adventurer, a family man, a businessman, a sportsman, or simply a really good mate, this man was one of a very rare breed of person. Like all people who knew Neil well, we are better people for the experience. Rest in peace, Neil. Thank you.
I think that Teledex there is actually sitting over on the table there, so if you get the chance a little bit later, there are some wonderful mementos there. Many of you may have heard that before. Many of you may have heard it a long, long time ago and thought you'd never hear it again. It wasn't Lee Marvin from Paint Your Wagons. That was actually Neil Kerley. He lost a bet to Barry Ian on his TV show while he was at Glenelg. I think it was over tipping. And with the bet, he had to then go and record a song on TV. And so Barb had just seen the movie Paint Your Wagon and said, well, I think maybe you could do a nice Lee Marvin. So he actually recorded it. And despite losing the bet, Curls had the last laugh. It actually went to number one on the charts here in South Australia. And I know Eddie and all the other Victorians are here again. What a surprise that would go to number one in this state. But it did. And I think that the family acknowledged that it was Curls' mum, Lillian, that bought all the 45s from the record shops that got it to number one. That's actually the B side. The A side is like a spoken word poem type thing called Old Tige, about a boy and his dog. So if you hunt around the bric-a-brac shops and the second-hand shops, if Lily hasn't got to all of them, you might be able to find a copy of that. So fantastic. You've got not just a football superstar, a wonderful family man, but we've got a rock star as well, which is quite amazing. Speaking of Glenelg, where he was when Curls recorded that, after he took South that amazing flag from bottom to top in 64, he moved to the Bay, and in his first season as captain coach at Glenelg in 1967, he blooded a couple of young teenagers who would go on 6 years later to be premiership heroes at the Glenelg Football Club and also become Hall of Famers. These men are our next guests, Graham Corns and Peter Marker. We're going to hear from Cornsy first.
That did not go to number one. Oh, I bet it did. He would have told you that. Just excuse me while I get my technology organised. look, thanks for coming. He would want it to be big, there's no doubt about it. He'd want a few tears, but he'd want laughter as much as anything. Look, leadership can be a hard quality to define because it comes in many forms. And leaders come in so many different shapes, sizes, and personalities. But if there's one word that defines Neil Kerley, it's leadership. He was born to lead, and as Wayne told you about some of his early childhood, his childhood was tough. He lost his dad at 11, left school at 14, left home at 16, but by the time he was 19, he was coaching men in Woomera, like hard men. These are hard men. He was 19. A year later in the steel town of Whyalla, which was a tough competition as well, he coached North Whyalla to a premiership and then repeated it the following year. He was still only 21. And the year after that, instead of accepting a coaching position in Mount Gambier, he went back to West Adelaide where he'd played a couple of games when he was a bit younger. And that's when the journey really began. If there is a golden era of South Australian football, it began in the early 60s. Now, that's when television brought the game into our lounge room. And it stretched through to the late 80s when the AFL overpowered us. Gil, thanks for coming. More about that later. It was a football era that defined a generation, and Neil Kerley's influence extended right through that whole period. And the names from that era are some of the greats of football, like Williams, Oatey, Motley, Head, Halbert, Cale, Ebert, Robran, Blight. Now, we can debate it, but Kerls was the most powerful, charismatic figure of that era. They called him the King, King Kerley. And there's only one king. And incredibly, the influence extended into the 90s when he helped set up the Adelaide Footy Club. He worked on Channel 7, was a state selector and an All-Australian selector for the AFL. Now, I know success has many parents, but without Neil Kerley, Adelaide probably doesn't win those premierships. Blighty, I will have this debate too. Because with Bob Hammond and Murray Tippett, he helped establish the core of that Crows first list. But most importantly, he brought Mark Ricciuto to Adelaide before one of those Victorian teams could get hold of him. So he was a much more skillful footballer than he's given credit for. He played 276 games at West Adelaide, as Wayne said, South Adelaide and Glenelg, and most of those were as captain coach when he always led from the front. He was club champion on 5 occasions. He lost the McGarry medal in 1965 by one vote. He could never forgive Gary Windo because he beat him on the last vote of the night. And for someone who played with such vigour and was always telling the umpires what to do, he polled pretty well over his career. But he was at his best at representing the state. He played an astonishing 32 state games. He hated Victorians, metaphorically speaking, okay? First as a player, then as a coach, then as a selected. He hated umpires, metaphorically speaking. He especially hated Victorian umpires, metaphorically speaking, of course. But of course, he became great mates with many, and some of them have made the trip over. We thank you for that. People often ask me, what was so impressive about Neil Kerley? Well, it's really hard to explain because he had this magnetic physical presence. He was a fantastic specimen of masculinity, but when he spoke, his words were captivating. It wasn't so much what he said, but more the way he said it. And a lot of basic stuff. Peter Carey and I were trying to work out what was the magic of his coaching, but it was the way he motivated you to do things like attack the ball, move it quickly, forward handball, find a teammate. At training, increase the degree of difficulty. He always wanted us to attack. It was never ever taking a backward step. You always had to go forward. Now, our teams kicked over 20 goals quite often. The West Adelaide boys will say their team was better, but we kicked 30 goals lots of times, and once we even kicked 49 goals, and John McFarlane hit the post for the last kick of the day. So, but if there was one thing that he drilled into us, it was never show weakness. Never back down, and never let them know you're hurt. And he practiced what he preached. The legendary story of the broken jaw and the chewing gum is true. He never went off the ground because he was injured, but we were playing centrals at Glenelg one day and he got his jaw smashed in the second quarter. And at halftime, he couldn't speak to us. So I remember him saying to Fred, stir him up, Fred, stir him up. But he got Laurie Rosewine to get a handful of juicy fruit chewing gum, munch it up, got this pulpy mass, took it, put it in his mouth, set his jaw around it, and played the last half of the game with a broken jaw, held together by chewing gum. Mind you, he missed the next 6 weeks because his jaw was wired together. The Friday night team meetings at Bellevue Heights were a ritual. Neil and Barb had a pool room. The photos of the highlights of his career on the wall, you know, the 63 state team, the South Adelaide, West Adelaide premierships, and we would peruse. We just wanted so badly to be on that wall. There was always a group in the corner playing cards before the serious stuff of the meeting started. There was one strict rule. If you dropped any money on the floor, it was the days when you played with money, that we had money, small change. If you dropped any money on the floor, you weren't allowed to pick it up. You had to leave it for Gail to come in on Saturday morning. That was her pocket money. And this is a bit brutal, but the team meeting always finished with the same message. Get plenty of rest, and you married blokes, keep your backside off the top sheet. Never had any instructions for the single blokes. He was the first football manager of the Adelaide Footy Club. Seems unbelievable, really, but he was. He really wanted to be the coach. We had these discussions, so I'm not talking behind his back. But he was nothing but supportive. The players loved having him around. When he spoke, they sat bolt upright. You know, they hang on every word. Such was his presence. But office work wasn't his strongest asset. But everything that gets done today to get a footy team on the ground and interstate and all the things that happen around a footy team to get them to play, he got done. There was just two in the football department, the secretary, Maria Ballastrin, and Curls. All the things that had to be done got done. We got to these games in Melbourne. Teams got on the ground. When we came home from interstate games, the laundry was hung up in the Kerley laundry. The night before Sean Wren's first game, Barb had to sew the number 52 on the back of his jumper. She complained about that. Couldn't he have a smaller number, like number 1 or number 7? Our first game in Melbourne was against Essendon at Windy Hill. It was round 4, 1991. It was Mark Bickley's first game, actually. And in those days, the AFL made us fly in on the morning of the same day, and the plane was slightly delayed. When we eventually got to the ground, it's called Windy Hill for a reason. All the flags had been taken down, and the windsock had been tied down as well. Typical cheating Victorian bastards. He I'd cut this bit out for time, but they said put it back in, so I put it back in. When we found the visitors' change room, we discovered that we had to share it with the North Melbourne reserves who were playing in the curtain raiser. But the North Melbourne doorman wasn't going to let us in. We're playing in this game, not going to let us in. Curl said one word. What? The guy just visibly melted, but there was more to come. The North Melbourne players had taken all the room with their gear. There was no room for our guys to change. So with Barry Downs, Barry's here somewhere, if you remember it well, and whoever was going to help, we gathered all the gear, bags, trousers, shirts, shoes, underpants, just dumped them in a corner in one big heap. I don't know what they thought when they came back in. There's a lot more to the adventure on that day, but in the end, we lost by 45 points. Welcome to the AFL. But he was always ready to take a hit for the team when the window of the coach's box at Waverley Park was mysteriously smashed after a typical Victorian biased umpiring decision. He took all the blame. It was me, he said. The media asked, how did that happen? He said, it was me. I lost my balance and fell into it. It wasn't him at all. He just took a hit for the team, or for me. Look, Neil Kerley was truly one of the greats of our state. There may be coaches with better records, but none did it like he did. Premierships at three different clubs, taking two from the bottom of the ladder to the top, then going back to his original club 22 years later and repeating the performances. Few have had such a long, sustained influence on football in this state. For many of us, he was the most dominant male figure in our lives. He gave us opportunities, he taught us lessons that changed our lives forever. Jacko said it earlier, but Laurie Rosemont is one of the greats of Glenelg, and he said it best a couple of weeks ago. He said, I loved him. I absolutely loved him. But we all did. He's with us forever. Long live the King.
Thanks, Barb. Thanks, Gail. Thanks to the entire Kerley family for the opportunity to speak today. I don't think Neil was definable, to be honest. I've sort of thought about it a bit. You know, I'm not a wordsmith, but I can't find a word or a catchphrase that sums him up. He's unforgettable. And I reckon one of the main determiners of unforgettability is first impressions. And I'd like to briefly recount my first encounter with and my first impressions of Neil Kerley. I was 11 and it was 1960 and I was playing for a junior footy team at the West Adelaide Footy Club. Awards night was coming up and our coach said, it's going to be a big night. You can train at Richmond Oval. After that, you can watch the league team train. Then you can get some autographs. And then we can have a pie night and then the awards. So it's the biggest night of my life. I've saved up. I bought an autograph book and a brand new pencil. And off I went. And I got the signatures of Kenny Eustace and Ronnie Benton, Ian Day and Bertie Johnson and a few others. And Jack Odie was the coach. And Jack walked up to me and he said, hello, young fellow. My name's Mr. Odie. Would you like me to sign your autograph book? I thought, yes, sir. Right, go with that. So fortunately, he had a biro because someone nicked my brand new pencil. I didn't have a pencil. So I got his signature and I turned around. I looked up and there he was. already famous, Neil Kerley, crew cut, the signature Kerley scowl, you know, the death stare, and a body that you could only get by cutting half a forest down with an axe. And he said, what do you want? And I was frozen. I could hardly speak. Your autograph? But he looked at me, and after a brief pause, he said, well, I can't sign it with my finger. So it was a few mumbles, and off he walked up the race. He gave my book back to me, no signature. And I thought, geez, he's a bit grumpy. He's a bit grumpy. So 6 years later, Glenelg Oval. He'd been appointed coach of Glenelg and pre-season training. I wasn't invited to train, so one night I just jumped the fence and joined in. And a little bit later, who are you? I told him who I was. He said, well, if you want to train here, you get a bloody haircut. So I thought, well, it's not a big price to pay, but... and I thought, geez, he's still grumpy. maybe he hasn't forgotten that autograph book incident. But I'm sure that there are many of us here that were coached by Neil, and you never forget that first night of training with Neil Kerley. Very difficult not to be in awe of him. I mean, he was... It's a bit of bromance here, I suspect, but he is ruggedly handsome. In those days, heavily suntanned. And, you know, he had a body that was hewn out of granite. I mean, he was a very impressive, very, very impressive figure. And he yelled out those orders in that raspy, gravelly voice of his. Only one man up. Cover the front. Lift your eyes, move it on, anticipate. Don't fall over, you're no good on the ground. 50 push-ups. No left hand, 2 laps. Cover the back, one man up, get the ball, concentrate. And that dreaded direction that he'd give to the team manager after training about a player who just wasn't measuring up. Send him home to his mother. She needs him more than I do. Not surprisingly, Neil had an affinity for Ned Kelly. I think he was in tune with Ned's healthy disregard for people in authority. Parking inspectors, Wayne, yeah, fishery inspectors. Didn't have a lot of time for them. Some politicians. Not including any politician who was here today. And, of course, football umpires. I think we've got a few umpires here today, but the most famous umpire, Kenneth George KG Cunningham. Now, we're not going to revisit the most famous incident in football 150 metres from here. I mean, it's been talked about so much, but I can remember... I reckon you were there, Ken, and I said to Neil, Neil, are you going to apologise to Ken? I mean, gee, you know, it's been nearly 50 years. I think it'd be a good idea to apologise. Apologise? Me? Apologise? Gee, I've been waiting nearly 50 years for Ken to apologise to me. Anyway, it wasn't a big hit. It was just a tap. I just put him to sleep for a while. But remarkably, and this says a lot about Neil and it says a lot about Ken, that was the beginning of a friendship that lasted a lifetime. It's truly, truly remarkable. So Neil was a bush philosopher, and there were quite a few words that he hated. You'd never say them in front of him after he'd told you. One of those words was competitive. He said, don't talk to me about competitive. If that's the only thing you want in life, you're never going to win. Okay, take that one out of the vocabulary. You won't use that one again. Another word that didn't sit well with him was potential. I'm not interested in what you might achieve at some time in the future. I'm only interested in what you can do now. Okay. Won't use potential anymore, that's gone. I remember saying to Neil, you know, Neil, what about diversity and inclusion and gender equality? What do you reckon about all of that? And, I support all of that. I support all of that. He said, but there's one thing that's more important, and that's equal opportunity. He said, if everybody in life is given an equal opportunity, he said, that'll trump all of that. And he said, don't take incentive out of the equation. He wasn't a fan of tokenism. As far as Neil was concerned, it was reward for effort. That was his philosophy. He was an outstanding speaker. Very little formal education, effectively self-taught, but he was the master of plain, direct speech. I remember him saying to me one day, he said, these days I'm coaching a few kids that have had college educations, and he said, I have to speak that way because he said, some of them are not very smart. he said, you know that Russian bloke, that Gorbachev fellow. You know, when Ronald Reagan said, you know, Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall. He said, that left no room for a misunderstanding. And he said, guess what? The wall came down. So, and he also jokingly said that President Ronald Reagan copied his style of speaking. Dinner at the Kerleys was more than a dinner. It was an event. In the early days, you get a phone call from Neil, just putting the menu together. Fellow worker, we got two choices for mains: duck and rabbit. Now, before you commit, he said, you know, you can sometimes get a few shotgun pellets in the duck, but he said, I got Barb on the job. He said, should be pellet free, no problems. And he said, Sunday morning, if you can, you get up at 5 in the morning, he said, we'll go down and check the yabby pots. He said, you might get a feed of yabbies for lunch. And we often did. I got a phone call from one day with Neil because at one point I held the record with Neil for the number of yabbies that we got in one outing. He rang me up one day and he said, your record's gone, it's broken. He said, Malcolm, blighty, he was up here on the weekend, he now holds the record. But he said, there'll be opportunities to break it. Don't worry about it. He loved a good red. I reckon he had 20/20 vision, Neil, because he could spot a good wine label from 20 feet. And you'd occasionally be out with him and he'd squint and he'd say, hey, pass that bottle up here. Get it up here. I just want to check the label. And he'd pour it in the glass and, whoa, shish. Said, now there are a few people on this table that do not appreciate a good wine, and this would be wasted on them. and he put it down on the floor just alongside of his alongside of his right foot to distribute according to his wishes, mainly to himself. He was also a lot of fun at charity auctions. You know, where you buy signed Guernseys and cricket bats and all that sort of stuff. And the byplay between Barb and Neil at charity auctions used to be quite interesting because Barb did the books, paid the bills, and Neil always used to get the charity auction going with his bidding. So $1,200, that started off. Barb be looking sideways at him, and a little bit later, $1,400. Neil, $1,600. Neil, Barb, don't worry about it. I know what I'm doing. I'm just getting the price up. $1,800. Neil, we don't need another cricket bat signed by Sir Donald Bradman. I think Neil and Barb quite often went home with stuff they didn't really need. A photograph a little while ago with the Neil's Teledex. Why would you put your phone numbers in your phone when you got one of these? He had it. I think he bought it from Sands at McDougall in 1958. Bit like that coffee mug. I think he had one coffee mug, a Ned Kelly coffee mug. I think he had it for 45 years. He dropped it, broke it several times, but he always glued it together and, you know, it still works. I well remember a casual conversation with Neil and about who would play him in a full-length Hollywood blockbuster movie. He said, there's only one bloke that can play me. Well, that's John Wayne. But he's dead. And he is indefinable. And as I said, I don't think there's a catchphrase that can adequately capture the quintessential Neil that was. And I thought about, you know, some writers that might have been able to do the job. And you think of John Steinbeck and Ernest Hemingway. You know, maybe they were gifted. Maybe they would have been able to do it justice. I've given it some thought, and I reckon there is a phrase that gets close. And I apologise to Neil for mentioning a poem, because I think Neil only read two books, and they were the ones about himself. But I'm not sure that he ever read a poem. Anyway, it's a poem from the school days, Ulysses, written by Alfred Lord Tennyson, in which Ulysses says, I will drink life to the lees, which essentially means I will exhaust all possibilities of life. And that's what Neil did. He exhausted all possibilities, all of the possibilities of his life, and he put every ounce of himself into those 88 years. You know, there are hundreds of enduring images of Neil. We've seen some of them here today, and there are hundreds and hundreds more. I like all of them, but the ones that resonate with me most, I reckon, are the ones where Neil is at one with nature. You know, chopping wood, shooting ducks, yabbies. I think in particular, one at Walker Flat, you know, very early in the morning, the mist would rise from the river and Neil would be out on his tinny. And you'd hear the putt-putt of the engine before you'd actually see Neil in the tinny. And then through the mist, Neil would appear. A couple of ducks, the yabbies, and just waving to all of the people that lived along the river and that Neil was great friends with. And he said, I don't know why you guys want to live in the city. He said, this is the place to live. He said, all you need is a good group of people around you, good family, a shotgun, a .22, a fishing line, you grow veggies out the back, and you can live like a king. That's exactly what he did. So Neil, I'm not saying goodbye, mate. Like a lot of people here, I loved you a lot. Unforgettable. Hard to put into words. Thank you, Neil.
And now the end is near, and so I face the final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear, I'll state my case of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full. I traveled each and every highway and more, much more than this. I did it my way. Regrets, I've had a few, but then again, too few to mention. I did what I had to do and saw it through without exemption. I planned each charted course, each careful step along the byway, and more, much more than this, I did it my way. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you knew, when I bit off more than I could chew. But through it all, when there was doubt, I ate it up and spit it out. I faced it all and I stood tall and did it my way. I've loved, I've laughed and cried, I've had my fill, my share of losing, and now, as tears subside, I find it all so amusing to think I did all that, and may I say, not in a shy way. Oh no, oh no, not me. I did it my way. For what is a man? What has he got? If not himself, then he has not to say.
I liked that song before, Wandering Star by Lee Marvin. I'd love to reveal that that was sung by Curls, but it wasn't. That'd be a lie, but I'm sure he could have done a really good job with it. We know that Knuckles' passion for state footy was legendary. He played 32 games for his beloved South Australia, as we've heard today, and obviously coached many others as well. And he loved nothing more than sticking it to those bloody Victorians, as he would say. And he often declared that, you know, that there are actually guys who can play and coach that aren't from Victoria. And he often told that to people across the border. But amongst that rivalry, there was a very healthy respect that extended across the border and was certainly reciprocated. Can you please welcome to the stage now one of those bloody Victorians, with respect, Eddie Maguire.
The representative of the Governor General of Australia, Governor of South Australia, Premier of South Australia, Barb and family, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I do stand here before you as a representative and a card-carrying member of those cheating Victorian bastards. There's probably a few people here today who are wondering why the former president of Collingwood, a proud Victorian, a Channel 9 bloke, 30 years younger than Neil Kerley, is up here to speak about our old mate. And the answer is exactly that, because we're all old mates. He was a great friend to me and so many of the old enemy of the big V. Neil was an enigma. For as much as he hated Victorian football, he loved it. As much as he despised those wearing the big V, they were amongst his greatest friends. And I have the honour of speaking on behalf of the likes of Barassi and Skilton and Murray and Schultz and so many more today, because Neil loved football and football people. And today the secret is out forever. We Victorians love Knuckles. As Lou Richards would say, what a he-man. As a kid growing up in the 70s before the superhero phenomenon of our heroes, as a kid growing up in the 70s before the superhero phenomenon, our heroes played footy on a Saturday. In Victoria they had names like Captain Blood, Jack Dyer, Basher Williams, E.J. Witten, Big Nick, John Nichols, and John Sammy Newman. Every so often a new name would float across from the border from exotic places like South Australia and WA, like Big Bad Mel Brown, and of course, Neil Knuckles Kerley. I remember seeing Knuckles on World of Sport one Sunday morning in Melbourne. Lou Richards got him to put his hands up. My eyes bugged out of my head. Hands like Melly Roots, that mad stare, that sense of menace. We weren't quite sure if he was joking or not. The first time I met Neil was at a training before a state match. I was a reporter in those days at Channel 10, only a young bloke, and as always the reception in the South Australian camp was frosty at best. They were there to kick a Vic. Back in the Vic rooms, EJ had adopted me, and we would be doing all those famous live crosses on the news, the master showman pumping up State of Origin football. Ted asked me how I was going with the Crow Eaters. When I replied not that well, he said this, follow me. Trailing in behind the great man, he walked over to the South Australian rooms and bashed on the door until some poor South Australian doorman answered, only to see Ted in full flight. Curly, get out of here! This is young Eddie. He's one of us. Look after him. Curls looked me up and down with that slightly quizzical look, then gave me the mad stare that we've heard about with those clenched teeth, looked up. He looked at EJ and said, okay, if you vouch for him. I felt like I'd been through a tribal initiation ceremony, and suddenly I was a mate, much to my eternal gratitude, of EJ and Cools, and then later Fatty Brown. These generous, fun-loving, macho men extended the hand of friendship, and in doing so, changed my life forever. Their generosity of spirit, their friendship, their commonality of purpose and sense of fun, the stories, the exaggeration, but the genuine courage, and most importantly, what is now seen as an old-fashioned concept, true friendship and manly love and regard for each other. That was the essence of Neil Kerley and his gang of footy legends. As time went on, Sam Newman and I would laugh at Curls in action as a boundary lighter, a rider. If people reckon I was one-eyed, Curls used to hide the injuries that he was supposed to be reporting on Channel 7. A player would be wrapped in bandages, a Crows player that is, wrapped in bandages and ice. Should be right back in a few minutes, you say. If an Adelaide Crow player virtually decapitated an opponent, Curls would say, nothing in it, glancing blow, nothing to see, move on. The whole of Victoria would be blowing up watching Channel 7 and Curls. And it became a drinking game at the awards ceremony at the AFL to work out which South Australian ended up in the All-Australian team because Curls had pushed them through. Some South Australian who'd had a goodish year would be announced the All-Australian night, and we'd all go, bloody Curls, he's got another one up. I didn't see Neil Kerley play. I didn't have to. The way the biggest names in football spoke about him as a player and a mate made it evidently clear that Knuckles was a gun. He was regarded in Victoria as a legend. The AFL sometimes has the romance and feel of the Australian Tax Office. Sorry, Gilbert, this is going to be your last job to do. Forget the TV rights. For not the first time, they missed the opportunity in life to recognise Kerls for what he was and will remain, and that is a legend of the game. Largely, and to give the AFL and Gil a bit of an out here, largely because he was still on the selection committee, pushing up his beloved Crowetters, but as Graham Corns told me recently, because he didn't quite fit the criteria for legendary status. A bit like Lou Richards, I guess. But that's what makes legends. They don't fit into spreadsheets. They are unscripted. They are original. When you meet them for the first time, you feel a force of nature, and that was Neil Kerley. I hope the Adelaide Football Club push hard for his inclusion, with the knowledge that the Collingwood Football Club will second the motion. President Geoffrey Brown is with us today and has said so, and he is here to pay respect from our club, the Magpies. Later in life, Knuckles would do me the honour of being my guest at every Collingwood Adelaide game at the MCG. Everyone at Collingwood had the utmost respect for him. He would grab my two sons and sit them down and give them some old-fashioned life advice. Talk about a finishing school, sitting at the footy with Neil Kerley. Not quite what Mum or maybe the teachers at Melbourne Grammar had been saying to him exactly, but leaning more towards what Dad was thinking. He'd invite them to go fishing and hunting on his property. Sleep under the stars, he'd say, around the campfire. I would see in their eyes the same fascination that I felt around Curls and EJ hearing all those stories. The game would start, of course. He would sit at one end of the aisle, I'd sit at the other, because the two of us, once the balls bounced, it was just on for young and old. But Curls was also a great source of support and inspiration. People may not know this, but when things were going bad at Collingwood for me, he'd send a message of support. Let me reiterate that. When things were going well at Collingwood for me, he'd send a message of support. When things were going bad, he'd be on the phone or somehow make his way out to see me. To be invited to Curls' Melbourne birthday lunches was magnificent, and every time I'd ask him to tell me the story of 1963 on the MCG when he vanquished the All-Star Victorian team. The pride, the joy, the emotion. In many ways, I'm glad Curls didn't make it to Victoria as a player or a coach, because we all knew he would have been a star, but he was just so South Australian, and I loved him for it. He was as ornery as you guys naming your teams from the forward line, not the back line. Having square goalposts, the footy budget, those power poles, the tin seats at Footy Park, the old airport where you walk across the tarmac like the Beatles did in 1964. And I just love the fact that he remained the archetypal South Australian, so proud of his beloved Adelaide and South Australia. Yet for all that, his great moments happened at the MCG and they were magnificent. 1963, those two amazing back-to-back Crows premierships, and the lap. Not only was it Ted Whitten's last lap, it was one of the most magnificent moments in our game's storied history. When the car stopped and Ted Whitten Jr. said, "Dad, it's Curls." And those two giants embraced for the last time. The very essence of our great game was there for all to see. The King and Mr. Football. Knuckles' greatest story about his comrades from Victoria, of course, centred around his great mate EJ Whitten. The day where Curls was sitting under a hospital pass and he could hear EJ running towards him like a herd of wild horses, and Curls yelled out, "Get it over with quick, EJ, get it over with quick." Remarkably, William Shakespeare said something similar in Julius Caesar. He wrote, "Cowards die many times before their deaths. The valiant taste of death but once. Of all the wonders yet I have heard, it seems to me most strange that men should fear, seeing death, the necessary end, will come when it will come." Vale Neil Kerley AM, Knuckles, Curls, King, a man who tasted death but once, who truly lived his life and went out on his shield, a warrior to the end, a legend in name and deed.
Thank you, Ed. Now, no doubt, Kerley's had an eye for talent, and amongst the thousands of lives and careers that he influenced and shaped, there's one player in particular that I know Barb and the family recognise that Neil himself saw a lot of himself when he was a young man in this particular player. Like Kerley, our next speaker as a player was courageous, he was tough, and he was uncompromising. And like Kerley, he's a boy from the Riverland. Please welcome Mark Ricciuto.
I've known Kerley for approximately two-thirds of my life, which was equal to one-third of his. Over those years, he was a coach, a mentor, and a mate. The first time we met is a story that's been told many times, but I thought should be told for one last one today. Kerley's come to Wakery without me knowing and sat with my dad, Murray, and watched me play for the Wakery A grade in 1991. Kerley was the footy manager for the Adelaide Crows, a club he shaped in the early years. He rocked up to Wakery with an esky full of beer and parked next to my dad in the spot that he had saved. "Where's the lad playing?" he asked Dad. "In the forward pocket," Dad replied. "I didn't bloody drive up here all the way to see the kid play in the forward pocket. Get him on the ball." Dad said, "How about we have a beer for every goal he kicks?" "Good idea." After I kicked my 10th, Kerley's should not have driven back to Walker Flat that night. But he did. The next week, because of Kerley's, I signed with West Adelaide and with the Crows, and it turned out that Kerley's would leave the Crows that year and coach West Adelaide. That year was 1992, and Dad and I did 52 400-kilometre round trips from Wakery to Adelaide to play footy as a 16-year-old under Kerley's while doing Year 12. My first game of league footy under Kerley's was a memorable one before it even started. It was at Laura, in the mid-north of the state, home of the Golden North ice cream, and it was a hot summer's day in early March. We caught the bus up there from Adelaide as a team. The three-hour trip was hot, and it was unusual for most of the side. The players wanted to stop for a drink, make sure they were hydrated. No one had the guts to go up and ask Kerley's if they could do that. In the end, a couple of the leaders did. Kerley's turned around and said, "You guys are piss weak. Camels go 3 days without a drink." Welcome to league footy under Kerley's. What a year it was. I look back at that year now and think how lucky I was to be coached by Kerley's. Yeah, it was busy and made sacrifices, but to play under one of the greatest coaches and motivators of all time was unbelievable. I was also lucky that year to be coached by Russell Ebert in the state under-18s. Ebert and Kerley. Not a bad duo to teach how to play footy in Adelaide. Kerley's coached the way he lived life. His guiding principles were very similar. He wanted his players to play with desire and have passion. He wanted you to believe in yourself, not in a cocky or boastful way, but just internally, he wanted you to think, "I can do it." He wanted you to dream and set goals, be realistic but ambitious, and work your backside off to reach them. Hard work was a non-negotiable for Knuckles, as it should be, and with honesty, with yourself and self-sacrifice. Every champion works harder than his competitors, he would say. Winners are prepared to pay the price. Are you? Persistence was important. Nothing is easy. Weak people stop at the first sign of opposition or misfortune. Competitors fight on. Personal responsibility. People must be honest with themselves and take responsibility for success and failure. He said, "Losers blame others and make excuses." Kerley's was always enthusiastic and positive, and he expected his players to be just like that. "Whatever you do, son, do it your best. Just go for it."
He wasn't scared of failure and wasn't worried about players making mistakes as long as they were having a crack. All successful people have failed. It's how you deal with the failure that's important. Courage. Kerls obviously loved it. He would say the difference between a successful man and a failure is not one that has better ideas or abilities, but the one that has the courage to have a crack, to take a calculated risk and to act. Do you want to be a winner, he would say. So for Kerls, for me, he was a coach, and then while I was at the Crows, he was a mentor. Towards the end of my AFL career, Peter and Jenny Hurley, along with my teammate Simon Goodwin, bought the rundown South Australian Brewing Company river property at Walker Flat, known as Sabaruma. With the help of the Burke family, we set about restoring the property to its former glory. The decision to invest in Aruma for me was one of the best decisions I've ever made, not for the financial reasons, but for the fact that this is where Neil switched from being a coach and a mentor to a great friend. For 15 odd years, we yabbied, fished, shot guns, cooked, drank, entertained and relaxed and spent time with our families. Most of my close friends who came to Walker Flat had the pleasure of meeting and spending time with Kerls and Barb. It was gold. I loved it. Sarah loved it. The kids loved it. Everyone loved it. Kerls would always hold court around a table of 10 or 12 adults of all ages and kids, drinking either a Cooper's beer or a Paracombe Red, telling stories and having all of us hang off every word he said. Poor old Barb must have heard the stories 100 times, but it didn't matter. You never said anything. Well, you did say a few things, actually, which made it even better, kept him on his toes. One day I decided to take one of the new shack owners at a room out yabbying with Kerls, just to make him feel at home. Barnsley, the new owner, was an ocean fisherman who loved crabbing, but had no idea how to catch yabbies. So we went off in Kerls' boat, stacked with nets and bait and a few beers. Barnsley said, "Where are we going to put the nets?" "Just around the corner," Kerls said. "How many nets are we allowed to have?" "Just enough, pal." As usual, with Kerls, we cleaned up. "How many yabbies are we allowed to catch, Kerls?" "Stop bloody asking questions," he said. We all know that Kerls could count money, but he couldn't count yabbies. Anyway, we ate the yabbies, we had a great day, we went off to bed, and it was another beautiful day on the river. The next day, I said to Barnsley, "Now don't tell anyone about this spot. Don't post any pictures on social media of the yabbies, and don't tell anyone how many nets we had or how many we caught." But Barnsley, he was a bit like Kerls. He didn't follow the rules. He goes and buys a boat, he goes and buys the nets, gets everything he needs, even spray painted the nets green, the floats green, just like Kerls, so the fishing inspector couldn't see him. Within a couple of weeks, he was down in the backwater, Kerls' favourite spot. He'd put all the nets in exactly where Kerls put them. He said he was just about to pull his first net and he felt this tingle come up his spine. He thought, shits. He looked around and there was Kerls. He'd snuck up on him. He didn't know what was going to happen, Barnsley. Didn't know if he was going to end up in the net himself. "You getting any, boy? You've set him in the wrong spot. You don't do it like that." Typical Kerls. He wanted you to feel nervous, but then he taught him how to catch him, and they were friends for a long time, Barnsley and Kerls. 3 or 4 weeks later, Barnsley went up to Barb's and Kerls to watch the game of footy because they had Foxtel, and they were up there with the General Phil Smythe, who I saw today. And Barnsley said he'd never seen so many fish. "What are they?" Barnsley said. "Callop." "Where'd you catch those?" "In the bloody river." Kerls didn't make the mistake of telling Barnsley where he got those fish again. Another great day was when KG and I took my older boys, Nick and Joe, up to see Kerls to catch some yabbies. KG and I were so excited to head up there and go yabbying. We both love Kerls, and on the way up there we were sharing stories in anticipation of what was going to happen for the day. Kerls had already set the nets. And the Kerls loved playing up to KG because he knew KG was a bit worried that we'd get done for too many yabbies or fishing inspector would be there. So we knew that we were going to have a great day. And we did. We caught a few yabbies, cooked them up and ate them. But while we were out there, there was a couple of sulphur-crested cockies giving Kerls the shit. Get the gun, Barb. So off Barb goes, like she'd done it before, walks out with a gun. Kerls went straight up like that and went bang. Shot the cockies. Feathers were going everywhere. The bird dropped down at our feet. KG was shitting himself, nearly having a heart attack. Kerls just got up, picked up the bird, whacked it in the freezer for future yabby bait. And I'm sure, yeah, KG nearly had a heart attack. But what a great day it was, KG, and we'll take that to the grave for sure. It was just another brilliant day. Midway through our time at Walker Flat, we also had some good luck. We were looking for a new manager for Sabaruma, which was not an easy thing to do in Walker Flat, finding an operator with experience. But I got a call from Neil. How you going, son? Yeah, good, Kerls, what's up? We need to have a chat. I started panicking. I thought, shit, what have I done? You know that job at Aruma? Yeah. My son Donald will do it. He's very good. He's run resorts all over Australia, and he wants to come home. Done deal. We couldn't believe our luck. Donald came back and did a brilliant job. He took the site to another level. He and his partner, Nicky, were amazing employees, and we always look forward to seeing them. Nicky was also a great cook, and Donald was full of praise for everything she did, just the same way that Neil would praise Barb. It was beautiful. Donald was a beautiful blend of Neil and Barb. Donald was always smiling and upbeat. He was hardworking, positive, thoughtful, and kind-hearted, traits inherited from his parents. People who stayed at Aruma could not believe they were getting looked after by Donald Kerley. We always looked forward to seeing him, and our kids absolutely loved him. Sadly, Donald passed away after a brave cancer battle, 3 years to the day that we lost Neil. Kerls was so much fun. He was tough, he was fair, he was always positive, he was passionate, and he was honest. He loved his footy and sport, loved his mates, fishing, yabbying, shooting, and the river. He was a proud family man, he loved his family. Kerls was the best storyteller and had stories to tell about all these things. To me, he was a living legend. One of the last true old school Aussies. Sadly, they are not making any more Neil Kerleys. Barb, Sarah and I absolutely love spending time with you and Neil. We always came away inspired by your love for each other and your family. We often said we'd love to live out our lives the way that you and Neil have. If we can instill Neil's values into our kids, then we know we've set them up for a good life. Rest in peace, Knuckles. See you up the river.
Beautiful words, Roo. Lovely spoken. And to all of our guests that have come up and spoken today, thank you so much. I think everyone really appreciates it. The stories are remarkable. We could go for another 3 or 4 hours comfortably, we know, with you guys being able to tell some amazing stories. That concludes the formalities for the state funeral. What I'd like to do now, though, is invite the pallbearers to come forward, please, and say their final farewells to Knuckles. You can make your way up, please, on this side of the stage via the stairs. All other guests, I ask you to be upstanding, please, if you're able to.
And much have I
Thank you, everyone. Please be seated. I'd now like to ask you all if you could please move to the stadium, and we're going to view a very special lap of honour on the hallowed turf where Kerley ruled supreme. Guests, if you'd like to